to our next installment of the series that we've called Conversations That Matter. I know some of you have been here before. This is a series that we began back in 2007 with the idea of presenting lectures and discussions on topics that we think are of contemporary relevance and importance. And we're seeking to do so intentionally from the perspective of a Christian worldview and then inviting dialogue on that perspective, inviting even disagreement and questions. Our topic tonight is homosexuality, the Bible, and public discourse. Hardly a week goes by without some media coverage of a case involving a clash in worldviews in the public square over these matters. The most public you know was the June of this year Supreme Court decision striking down the Defense of Marriage Act. This was followed shortly thereafter with the announcement from the Federal Treasury Department in August that even in states where their marriage isn't recognized, legally married same-sex couples can now jointly file federal taxes. In August of this year, the New Mexico Supreme Court upheld the application of the state's anti-discrimination law to a wedding photography business that had refused to photograph a same-sex commitment ceremony on the basis of their religious opposition to such ceremony. One of the justices in that case acknowledged that the couple involved was being, quote, compelled by law to compromise the very religious beliefs that inspired their lives, end quote. Similar cases are now pending in Colorado, Illinois, New York, Oregon, and Washington. In our own church and other churches around the country, many would know that we've had to work through the implications of the recent decision of Boy Scouts of America to allow openly gay scouts to participate in the programs. These issues are here to stay, and the challenges raised by them are not going away anytime soon. So how do we live peaceably together in a society where very real social, moral, and deeply religious differences exist between us? What are we to do when matters of conscience come into conflict with civil law? These are the kinds of questions that we hope to address tonight. Our speaker tonight will be familiar to some of you. She was a part of this series last year. She spoke last evening at USF. Dr. Rosaria Butterfield is a former professor of English and Women's Studies at Syracuse University, and her memoir is titled The Secret Thoughts of an Unlikely Convert. We asked her tonight to focus her comments on the challenges of holding Christian, that is, biblical commitments in a cultural context where those convictions are found increasingly to be at odds with civil laws and practices. As we always do, after her presentation, we'll open the floor for discussion, for questions. There's microphones at the end of each aisle where you can come forward and ask your questions. The format tonight will be a little bit different in that we'll actually have a panel answering those questions. The panel will consist of me, our assistant pastor here at the church, Dustin Udaly, Kent Butterfield, Rosaria's husband, who is the pastor of First Reformed Presbyterian Church of Durham, North Carolina, and Rosaria. Because I am a Christian minister and we are operating here, at least from up front, from a Christian perspective, I'd like to open our time in prayer. So even if some of you may not be comfortable with that or may not believe even in the God that we're addressing, we'd like to just pause for a moment and pray for his blessing on our time. God, we do bow before you and acknowledge you as our God and our Father, who in the Lord Jesus Christ has purchased us for yourself in our salvation. And we thank you that you have not left us in the darkness to make our own way in the world, but you have revealed yourself to us in the scriptures of the Old and New Testament and in the person of your Son, Jesus Christ. And we do ask your blessing on our time tonight, that even where there is deep disagreement, there would be mutual understanding, and respectful dialogue. So we ask your blessing by your Spirit on our time tonight. In Christ's name, amen. So please welcome again Dr. Rosaria Butterfield.
Thank you. Can you hear me? Okay. In 1996, when former President Bill Clinton signed DOMA, I grieved with my people. In 1996, I was an atheist, and I lived in a monogamous lesbian relationship, working as a professor specializing in English literature and queer theory. I was on the track of becoming a tenured radical, receiving tenure in 1999. A few months ago, in June 2013, the Supreme Court delivered its historic DOMA decision. I am now a Christian, married to a man who serves God as a pastor, and I homeschool in the classical tradition, the two youngest of my four children. And again, I grieve with my people. Perhaps you think I have a knack, you might even call it a spiritual gift, of affiliating with the losing team. One of my enduring life values, which carried me through the feminist and gay rights movements of the 1990s and continues to motivate me today as one of Christ's own, is the desire to stand with the disempowered. So here I am, standing in a familiar place, bearing a new heart supplied by the Holy Spirit, a renewed mind transformed by Christ's atoning love, a new mission created from before the foundation of the world by God's sovereignty, and a new identity as the daughter of the King. But here I stand, still sporting my comfortable shoes. Some things change, some things never do. Like God, the same yesterday, today, and tomorrow. This has been an electric season for a former lesbian, now Christian disciple. Everywhere I turn, the Bible and its teachings are demeaned, dismissed, and discounted. Everywhere I turn, I am faced with the world that I helped create and that I once believed with all my heart accomplished peace for the world and justice for all. The conflict between LGBT rights and the Bible square off in complex ways. Take, for example, Exodus International closing down. Truth be told, this was fine by me. I don't believe reparative therapy was part of God's method, and I don't believe that Jesus Christ died for the parachurch. But Exodus detonated with a colossal bang and took with it gospel integrity, leaving even more theological turbulence in its wake. And now the Supreme Court, using strong cosmological language, moral language indeed, defending the human dignity of same-sex unions, overturned DOMA and Proposition 8, sending a resounding rebuke to the Christian ideal of creation ordinance, and with it, the normative, albeit not always redeemed, heterosexuality that undergirds it. The day the Supreme Court issued its decision, I did what parents across the country did. Believing parents and unbelieving parents, gay parents and straight parents, I gathered my children in close, and I talked with them. You probably did this too. No big surprises in my talk, no new news, no identity bombs were dropped. My children have always known that their mother used to be an atheist and a lesbian. They cut their teeth on this vocabulary and could say the words before they knew what they meant. Saved by grace, closets are for clothes, after all. We talked about people and their hearts and their worldviews. We walked while we talked, our golden retriever Sally leading the way and our little Shih Tzu Bella tugging at Sally's ankles. We found toads and frogs, relocated an injured cicada and transplanted butterflies. We stopped to greet and embrace neighbors on both sides of the worldview divide. We took comfort in their familiar embrace, the scent of garden dirt in their hair and on their faces. We basked in a lush North Carolina summer day, full of blooms and butterflies and God's common grace, that is, the gifts that God gives to everyone. And in this journey, we told and retold the adventures of God's creation, the agony of our fallen Adam, the compassion of Christ's redemption and resurrection, and the responsibility for Christians to pray for those who cannot find the throne of grace, blinded, as we all once were, by the great enemy of sin, deceived to believe that sin is our identity and our friend. I felt the worldview shift in a visceral way that day. The day the Supreme Court weighed in on DOMA was big. From here on after, Christians would have to defend not only what the Bible says, but why and how we can believe it. Christians could no longer make arguments based in natural law to argue against homosexuality. And I say, good riddance to those natural law arguments. They always seem to atrophy into cultural bias or a kind of blathering moralism. But the Bible is different. God breathed in its origin, inspiration, and God shielded from impurity by God's nature covering it, inerrancy. The Bible is true, trustworthy, dependable, and unsullied by culture, convention, or corruption. So today is a new day, Christian, and God will have no more arguing against morality or lack thereof. Now we will have to argue for scriptural integrity. And our audience will be predisposed to believe that anyone arguing for scriptural truth is either a bigot or a moron or both. And it may look like an uphill battle, but I'm no Sisyphus, the Greek god who spent eternity pushing that rock up the hill. I have a soul that will last forever in loving union with Christ. God intends great things for his people who walk in humility, especially when we play on the losing team. Indeed, if the Bible is true, then at one point in my life I was dead, and if the Bible is false, then I'm simply the biggest fool on earth. So as you can see, I take all of this personally and on the chin, and perhaps you do too. When I lived at enmity with God, I enjoyed the benefits of what Christians call common grace. All of God's creation does. Sun shines on the wicked and on the righteous, God tells us in the Bible. But common grace isn't as sweet on its own terms, at least not for me. Saving grace gives common grace its majesty. Back then, my anxiety was bigger than lush summer days, and facing the problem of self-determination in daily full force overwhelms a soul designed to worship the holy God who created me and takes care of me. Same sun, same butterflies, different point of view, all equaled for me an uninspired experience of common grace. Common grace never gets to the soul level, where real healing takes root. The point of view of sexual sin, both the heterosexual and homosexual variety, is wild, fickle, and unrestrained by logic or kindness. As I fought in a political way for greater personal and social sexual liberty, I suffered under the society I was helping to create. One no longer protected by God's covenantal love, one no longer providing norms or standards with a vision and root beyond itself, and extending from before the foundations of the world. Before the foundations of the world. That makes evolutionist claims of millions and millions of years look like a hair on my golden retriever's molting coat. Before I knew Christ's atoning love, exalted assertions of freedom met with ecstatic arousals and deep depression. The need to daily recreate the meaning of your life is exhausting. Back then, summer blooms and butterflies could only provide distraction from my capricious heart, not usher me to Jesus, the heart that beats for me. So today my heart beats because of Christ's heart, and the blooms and the butterflies reflect God's creation and point me to Jesus, the God-man, who is tempted in all things yet without sin, and where the life of service, sacrifice, and suffering and resurrection become both palimpsest and paradigm for all things good and evil, and where providence promises that all things good and evil will work together for God's glory and even my good, my broken mess of a life made whole in Christ. A million ways to shatter, one embrace of wholeness. So here is what I know. God is bigger than my sin. Today's sin is bigger than yesterday's, even though yesterday's fell under a scary moniker, homosexuality, and today's just slips under the radar. Impatient, angry homeschool mother makes no headlines, although it should. But this is true. God is more angry at me for the sins that I commit today as a believer than anything I did as an unbeliever. God is sovereign over Supreme Court decisions and shifting worldviews. He has had the first and he will have the last word on all matters of sin and grace. The church, Christ's bride, is a God-made institution and will sustain herself in majesty in times of persecution or revival. Context matters not. Providence will paint the walls of this worldview. Bakeries close, Barilla Pasta is vilified, and I hope that as persecution comes, and I believe it will, that Christians will not become a whiny, self-interest group begging for mercy from men in charge, bowing before the great idol of approval. Christians should beg only from God, not from Caesar. Some will say that the Orthodox Christian Church has created a false binarism between gay and Christian, and some will say that no such divide exists. Some do this by denying the authority of Scripture and the Old Testament in particular. But Jesus, the Word made flesh, will not be drawn and quartered. He came to fulfill the whole law, every jot and tittle. When we can't discern the moral law of the Old Testament from the judicial and ceremonial laws, we don't know what whole tastes like, looks like, smells like, and saves like. God wants your whole life relinquished to him. And any theology that denies the moral law of the Old Testament and then domesticates sin by its absence does not have Christ's atoning love, God's justifying pardon, or the Holy Spirit's kind company. The red letters of the New Testament unmoored from the moral law of the Old Testament offer only half the God-man, mangling the gospel by wrenching salvation from sin and belief from repentance. Even the demons believed in Jesus, and it only sent them straight to hell. All dangerous lies pack a dollop of truth, and that was true when Jesus walked the earth, and it is true today. That we are saved from our sin simply reveals the obvious. God was right all along. There is no shame in a love or in a truth that loves like this. The Bible is not some pragmatist paradigm. It is the double-edged sword that chiseled truth into my stony heart, rendering it new and with it recreating me as a new creature in Christ, a daughter of the King. I have no sexual orientation after Christ chisels my heart anew, and neither do you. We have Christ orientation, an alien identity to which we claim no rights. Do we struggle with sin? Yes. Is temptation a sin? No. What distinguishes temptation from sin? Temptation clobbers you from the outside and lures you to do its bidding. Sin makes temptation a house pet, gets it a collar and a leash, and is deceived to believe that it can be restrained by impositions of civility. What you do with temptation reveals who owns your heart. How you talk about other people's sin also reveals who owns your heart. So here's what I have learned from being on the losing team of both historic public and political renderings of homosexuality. Homosexuality is a sin, but so is homophobia. Homophobia is a rational fear of a whole people group, failing to see in that group God's image, diminished but not extinguished by sin, and that God's elect people linger there. Snared by their own design and awaiting God's gospel grace. Biding time. Think about that. Waiting like the caterpillar that spawned today's butterfly, God has set apart a people from before the foundation of the world to receive his grace, and they are waiting for you in every nation and people group. It is an act of homophobia to believe that people in the LGBT community are either too sinful to respond to God's call on their life, or to believe that people in the LGBT community have a fixed nature that will never, by the blustering, unfounded, and uncharitable declarations of secular psychology, change by the power of the gospel. The only fixed feature of the human constitution, or badge of personal identity, is the soul. Imprint of God to us, it will journey from life to death to life and will last forever, permanently for eternity in heaven or hell. The gospel reorders and remakes people, and its metamorphosis manifests in a life that loves God more than itself. God doesn't zap us. He walks us through the valley of the shadow of death, promising that as we, quote, proclaim and initiate an irreconcilable war against our choice sins, as Puritan William Gurnell states, God will be there, the rock, never leaving nor forsaking, never failing the soul who puts trust in him. No matter what, God promises that he will make meaning, purpose, and grace out of your redeemed life. God provides the church to be family from cradle to grave, where single Christians are cherished saints in Christ's kingdom, not people waiting to be fixed or fixed up. And God provides Christ-redeemed heterosexual marriage so that his creation ordinance is fulfilled and so that his bride, the church, has imaginative authority over our hopes and our dreams. So the day in June when the Supreme Court rendered its decision and the moral, cultural landscape gestalted ended for me with the laughter of children. My husband at the time was away at the Reformed Presbyterian Church's annual meeting of synod, so my children's bedtime standards, well, actually all of our standards when Kent is gone, follow this principle: lower your expectations, increase your joy. I think we should put that on holiday wrapping this year. What do you think? After careless showers, I think my son wanted to know if there really was soap in the shower. No, never. I never keep soap in the shower. Sporting their summer PJs, wolfing down dinner of leftovers while standing up, my children head out to greet the neighbors. With flashlights and mason jars with punctured lids, we start our adventure at the pond. We marvel at the symphony of frog songs, stopping at the tree where the Scopes Gray tree frogs congregate. My son pulls back a branch to reveal a chorus, their bubbles expanding to full expression as they echo their back and forth catechism. We run through the woods with the dogs, and the children were pretending that the woods are filled with aliens. Certainly our hearts are, I think. While the children spar with imagined aliens, the parents hash out some real ones, and questions spill like summer showers. How can homosexuality be a sin when my brother is so happy at last? Asks one neighbor. Why would a holy God humiliate himself to walk this earth embodied by human corruption, giving his empathy to those who would nail him to a cross? I ask in return. We are not debating. We are not sparring. We are lamenting, mourning, grieving, each singing in a different key. Someone's brother, someone's neighbor, the person I used to be, my Savior, my God, my grief, his grace, my repentance, his condemnation, my justification, his agony, my victory, his stripes, my healing, his curse, my blessing, his thorns, my glory. It may seem just now like I displaced someone's beloved gay brother for my long God list. I did. I must. You see, my life is on the line, and so is yours. God is bigger than my sin, and to see that, I must adjust my point of view. I must put my problems in the shadow of the Almighty, nail my sin to the cross, and make the Lord the sole object of my trust. I must, and you must, and this is real love. And this is, I believe, the real worldview divide. The me I used to be valued community above all else, and sought always to find peace there. The me that God has transformed finds peace with him through the sacrifice of Christ and through repentance of sin. The sacrifice of Christ, a real historical event that changed the world. The Bible, its inspired and inerrant history book. Sin is such a stark word, so hard to grasp and to say. How can I declare sin sinful when it feels just like me? I get it, I really do. Which is the harder pill to swallow, that the resurrection changed history or that the Bible is history? So glorious a promise that the God who made you will take care of you from cradle to grave, and that all things are made new by his blood. One drop of his blood remakes a life intended for all eternity. Soon the children flop like littermates on the grass, embracing with wide eyes the stars, silence, crickets, stars. The day locks there for me. I don't want to breathe. I don't want anything to shatter this moment. Psalm 147:3 incarnates this snapshot for me. He heals the brokenhearted and binds up their wounds. He counts the number of stars. He gives names to all of them. I want to savor this ardent promise with the pores of my skin, yawning vulnerably in this muggy North Carolina night. Someone makes the first move. She must. We are, after all, responsible parents. We come back to the ho-hum, sticky with bug spray and sweat. With a collective exhale, we release our fireflies into the darkness. It's okay, this darkness. As neighbors, we have said much tonight, maybe too much. We have stepped on toes, laid down our cards, aired our laundry, and shared our hearts. We will need to talk again, maybe to apologize, maybe to pray together, maybe to cry together. We will need to pray to the God who made us all and who wants to redeem us in unity in Christ. My daughter is tired and climbs on my back for a piggyback ride home, and my son shines the light at our path. Like Psalm 119, we mumble together. We watch the stars and the fireflies. I thank God that they give him glory with one singular light. And it is for the hope implied in that one single light that Christians must find their voice in our public discourses over sexuality and gospel truth. Good neighboring requires this. In the time that we have left, I want to take up one question about sexuality in the Christian faith that I am repeatedly asked and that shines light on this position and posture of good neighboring that I believe is the important posture of the Christian right now in a public discourse. Why did I have to give up my girlfriend for Christ? Why couldn't I have both? After all, can't someone believe in Jesus and be gay? So let's unpack this. Number one, can someone struggle with homoerotic attraction and be a faithful believer in Christ's atoning work? Yes. Jesus was tempted in all things, and so too are we. But two, can someone unrepentingly embrace and deny as sin homoerotic lust, allowing it to flourish and root as a practice and an identity, and then add Jesus to this identity and call it a Christian faith? No. Why no? Why isn't this no an example of homophobia and its rejection of the idea that the individual sets the terms of her own sexual identity? What about people whose gender identity is clearly liminal, or people who perceive themselves to be born with a deep and abiding and unrelenting sense of gay identity and selfhood? Well, because the Bible is sufficient for how we understand sexuality and how we mortify sin, we do not need to add anything to it when seeking help, It is simple and difficult all at the same time. We are all born this way, every single one of us, although what this references may be different. We are in the same boat, millions of ways to be shattered, one way to be made whole. Salvation begins with God's sovereign initiation, not with my intellectual assent to a moral framework and a normative sexuality, or a set of ideas, or a desire to get rich or have a happy life. It is a dangerous lie to say that Christians are people who merely believe in Jesus, because indeed even the demons do. Of course, lies are called half-truth for a reason. Dangerous lies often do contain large dollops of truth. And the idea that a Christian is merely someone who believes in Jesus is the whopper deception of this present age. After God's sovereign invitation and after the Holy Spirit removes the heart of stone and replaces it with a heart of flesh, we fall on our faces as we hear the still small voice of God. We relinquish our lives to him as his sovereign grace commands this. We relinquish all of it, and we keep nothing back. And this includes our sexuality. We were born this way. We were all born this way. And that is what it means to have Adam as our representative head, to have fallen with Adam in his first sin, and to be born with original sin. How do we hear God? Is it an audible voice? No. God speaks to us through the language of the Bible. The Bible is key. We train our ears to hear the Lord by drinking deeply of his holy word, his direct word, not the themes that we make up or the ideas that we imagine. Nothing that we create will ever have the power to save, discern, and sanctify. Not one creation of ours will come close to the sharp edges and sanctifying blood of our Savior. We commit our lives to the Jesus of the Bible, the Word made flesh, who came to fulfill the whole law of God, every jot and tittle. We do not use our own personal experience to verify the validity of God's commands. The Christian faith is not a pragmatic one. We die to the old man or old woman and become alive in Christ, or we do not yet know him. He is the potter, we are the clay. In sanctification, God grows us in a likeness of Jesus by drinking deeply of the means of grace, Bible reading, psalm singing, worship, taking the sacraments, church membership, fellowship with other believers, the perseverance of the saints. In so doing, we take our rightful place as sons and daughters of the covenant. We do not look to ourselves to see if we measure up, because we don't. We look to Christ. When Jesus died and rose again, he gave sin a mortal blow. Thomas Brooks compares our sin to a tree that has been cut to the roots. The tree may pop a few leaves, but its inevitable fate is death. And so too we see our sin. It no longer comes at us with full potency. It is a lion with its jaws wired shut. Sin may sucker punch us, but never slay us, because Christ's death gave sin its inevitable death. We grow in sanctification in two directions. We grow in humility about the power of sin to overwhelm us, and we grow in the ability to conquer sin. And both count as growths in grace, humility and victory. And that is how Christ heals us from the consequences of our sin, whatever that sin may be, by giving us victory over it, by never divorcing us even when we fall and we fail and we're weak, and by giving himself to us as an example. Christ did not die all at once upon the cross, so also the slaying of sin is gradual in the souls of saints, says Thomas Brooks. Sexual sin has many tendrils, but by Christ's stripes we are healed. He pours the supernatural balm of Christian victory into the grooves of our sin patterns, our body memories, until the holes are filled with his grace, and until attacks and seductions no longer stop us in our tracks. And that is what it means to be a Christian. God separates us unto the gospel to reveal his Son in us. And recognizing that God gave us our will, we put our will on his altar. We use God's vocabulary and God's dictionary. We call sin, sin, no matter what our personal feelings or experiences on the subject. and we call grace, grace, and we drink deeply from its well. We are God's image bearers, and we encourage other image bearers to spend more time looking at the original than its reflection. And we do not domesticate sin by calling it something else. Indeed, it is just a persistent question for our time, and one that Christians must have a public voice in addressing. Can a person retain an unrepentingly gay identity and claim Christ's headship, lordship, and salvation? Identity is simply not up for grabs to the Christian. Christ will have all of us, not part of us. We will struggle with all manner of sin and temptation in this world, but nowhere in the Bible is there a recorded prayer where anyone gets to order up his own personal program for what victory looks like or what sanctification might be. If we blame God for our lust and then declare that we can only be of good use to him if he gives us over to it, we are being petulant children, engaging in a form of self-pity, but not prayer. I speak for myself here. Sadly, we often call this prayer, but self-pity is truly the furthest thing from prayer. So what then is the Christian response? What is the Christian public response to our friends in the LGBT community and in relationships? I think we have to go right to Ephesians 1. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places in Christ. Just as he, the Father, chose us in him, the Son, before the foundation of the world, that we would be holy and blameless before him, in love, he predestined us to adoption as sons through Jesus Christ to himself, according to the kind intention of his will. Recently, someone said this to me, Rosaria, give up this ministry. It is dangerous and unnecessary. And those people are going straight to hell anyway. But I believe that God's elect people are in the gay and lesbian community as well. And that changes everything. Ezekiel 37:3 puts this point in terms of a question. Son of man, can these bones live? What about my bones or yours? Were they somehow less dead? Do we remember the humbling moment when we first knocked at God's door, standing there, the crucified thief? And to this you might say, Rosaria, if God's elect people are in the gay and lesbian community, why aren't they rushing to our churches and saying, how can we be saved? Why instead do we see whole branches of the Christian faith combining with a secular morality, rejecting orthodoxy for revisionism, and domesticating the sin of homosexuality and declaring a false peace? Dear Christian, is it possible that we are perhaps in no small part to blame? I've said it before, homosexuality is a sin, but so too is homophobia. And homophobia is the unrestrained fear of gay and lesbian people and the whole cell writing off of their souls. So let's look at a familiar passage, 1 Corinthians 10:13. You know this one, no temptation has overcome you, but such as is common to man. And God is faithful, who will not allow you to be tempted beyond what you are able, but with the temptation will provide a way of escape also, so that you will be able to endure it. Now think about this. What if the way of escape for our brothers and sisters in the LGBT community is your house or mine, your church or mine? Are we part of the problem or the solution? Are we good company for the suffering? Do we secretly harbor the heresy that people's world-defined identities overpower God's imprint of his soul upon us? Are we willing to speak the truth in love across the long haul of unconditional friendship? Do we not want to rock the boat with gospel truth? Or do we only want to rock the boat, reducing people who do not yet know Christ to stereotypes, to mock and despise, rendering people as ghost stories? Are we so afraid of breaking our hearts on the rock of Christ as we shake the gates of heaven in prayer that we would simply rather despise others? Indeed, Christians must find the voice of a good neighbor in our public discourse. The words we speak are like a table setting for the hospitality that we are called to share with the stranger at the gate. Words of gospel truth set Christ's table and manifest his call, "Come unto me," says Christ. The call is to come, not to dispute, quibble, or sorrow. And this is, after all, what good neighbors do. Thank you.
Well, this time, if you, our panel's gonna come up and be seated here. And if you have questions, if you'll just come to the microphones, and we'll just alternate back and forth for questions. The first question is always the hardest. So somebody be bold and come to a microphone and offer up a question. We're not leaving, so we'll wait.
It seems like there's a lot of a strong cultural trend, as you said, toward public acceptance of homosexuality outside of the specifically religious argument. I just found out today, just reading through benefits literature, that my company now extends benefits coverage to domestic partners, as an example. I'm an owner of this company. My co-founder of the company is also a strong Christian, but we try to defer to people who are experts in HR on that kind of topic. But it's just, at this point, it's, I think, accepted among the experts and among the people who are typically making these decisions that that's standard policy. Is that something that is wrong for me to allow the company to do that, even though it's not subsidized? And should we be actively fighting that part of the cultural battle, or should we defer and focus on the spiritual side of things?
And they all look at each other. I guess I would start off by saying you hit the nail on the head. There are serious complexities in how we're going to have to address these kinds of issues, because not every issue in the social sphere is going to be able to be addressed with the same kind of clarity, perhaps, as other issues. So, for example, the marriage question, I think we would probably all say, the Bible speaks very clearly about marriage and defines marriage very clearly. It's a black and white sort of issue, so it's a little bit easier for Christians to speak clearly to that. But when you start getting down the line on the kinds of questions you're asking, I think it's there aren't always black and white answers to those kinds of questions. And I think one thing that we're going to need to do is to converse about them in the Christian community. So with the leaders of your church, sitting down and having dialogue, you know, many of us as Christians will know that the Bible also tells us that we're required to submit to the governing authorities. So there are legal issues involved in some of these things. And it's just not always going to be a simple black and white yes or no answer. And I'm not trying to cop out on your question, but I'm trying to say that some of these kinds of questions are not going to be simple, off-the-cuff kinds of answers. So that's my first thought, and I'll let one of the other panelists tell you what you should do.
Yeah. They're all looking at me. I guess I would say, I mean, I would agree with what Steve said. I think in that type, this type of situation, I really would call upon Christian lawyers to rise up, because, you know, we're talking about legal issues, and I believe that whatever is your vocation as a Christian, you should manifest yourself as a Christian through that vocation. I mean, do your work unto the Lord, yes, but let it be known that you're a Christian. And so we need the help of Christian lawyers and Christian judges who will live out their faith. I don't think there's a depart, you know, I don't think you departanize your faith. You know, you make it known. And so we need the help of those in the legal field. So, I mean, at the very least. So, yeah, there's, I don't know the specific answer, but we are to live as Christians. We are to work as Christians. We are to honor the Lord as best we can in all things. And how to do that in sticky situations, we need the help of other Christians. So that's a general principle I would suggest.
I guess I would throw in there, if you're sensing the tension, I think there is the call, as Rosaria put so well, that we love our neighbors. And as we know from the parable of the Good Samaritan, that is, our neighbor is without qualification, which would absolutely include homosexual employees or any sort of employees that we may have. So we're called to honor these people as image bearers, whoever our neighbor might be. So there's common decency and courtesy that extends beyond just acknowledging their humanity, but then honoring it in practical ways. But then the other edge, the dangerous, you know, other side of that ledge, is that we are also called most ultimately to honor the supremacy of the Lord Jesus Christ, and we never calling evil good and good evil. And so any way that would even implicitly support, endorse a lifestyle that we believe is sinful, would be the other side of the ledge. And I think you're hearing that kind of razor's edge tension, and then trying to take those biblical principles and apply them into particular situations does require wisdom. So like Steve said, go talk to your church leaders.
I guess I'll add one other aspect to think about. There are many societies, if you think of the former Soviet Union, where there have been Christians, there have been churches who existed in a suppressive state, and they were forced to do things, or they did not have laws of liberty or freedoms. We're living in a nation, in a world, where we start out with liberties and it's going away. And I believe it's a unique time in history for what was once a Christian nation, however you want to define that, where we're shrinking in that liberty. And so, you know, how to adjust to that? I mean, I think we all want our liberties, and we should fight for them, but how to fight? You know, this is a spiritual warfare, and so we really need to be pouring out our hearts in prayer. Us pastors need to be preaching the whole counsel of God, and Christians, wherever you are, home, work, school, live out the faith. Let it be known you're a Christian. Do works of faith. Share the testimony of the faith, and not be ashamed of Christ. And we are where we're at, I believe. I don't think any most Christians would argue, we are where we're at because we have retreated over generation, over generation. We have the bunker mentality, and we're being overrun, and it's our fault. It's not God's fault. It's our fault. And so we need to have a holy boldness with humility, and the boldness is in Christ. We boast of him, and we use the word wisely, but faithfully and openly. And so we need to recapture where we should have been. So we America, many generations have gotten us to this place. So it's not a Supreme Court decision that will resolve things, or a Christian president, but the collective nation being humbled in prayer and living out the faith.
On the issue of recapturing, I just want to pick up on that thread, because recapturing is the language of war. And so I'd just like to, I'm curious about the idea of political advocacy, because there's some of that you're speaking of just moments ago. I take Ms. Butterfield's comments about being a good neighbor, which I think is one of the main themes of her talk, to heart, and I think it's a great theme. But then we come up against the rhetoric of victory, winning, losing ground, gaining back ground, and you combine that with the thought of the good neighbor. And it seems that there might be something of a clash of ideas if we just start with the DOMA controversy, for example. DOMA, I guess, is a law that is prescribing something about gay marriage and prohibiting gay marriage. Those who advocate for gay marriage do not feel that you're being a good neighbor when you advocate against gay marriage. And they will not feel that way. And I wonder if you could just comment on that, at merging these concepts of being the good neighbor, but also of advocacy and the rhetoric of, well, we've lost ground, which we should regain. Thank you.
As you can probably tell from my talk and just the reality of my life, I've spent a lot of time, well, as I told you, on the losing team. And I've also spent a lot of time thinking about what it does mean to be a good neighbor. I am very grateful that when I, before I knew who God was, I did have a Christian neighbor. His name was Ken Smith. And we were in Syracuse, where neighbors really do take neighboring seriously, because you could just die in that cold, right? You know, knowing who has the snow blower is, you know, of paramount importance. And, you know, I had a wood-burning stove. And, you know, we took that really seriously, because we were called and are called to look out for one another's physical well-being. And I hope that there is nothing I said tonight that would imply that I am not standing in defense of the dignity and humanity of all people, including my friends in the LGBT community. But one of the things I've come to learn and appreciate as a Christian is that Christ wants all of us, and that Christ gives all of himself to us. And so for me, you know, and I'm always in a funny place. I was one of the original co-authors of the first domestic partnership policy at Syracuse University. And I got a lot of flack from my, you know, Christian neighbors from that, as you might imagine. But one of the things that we Christians are not called to do is to put laws in place that encourage people to be at odds with their maker. So those are some of the questions that we need to think about. Are we encouraging in a large way a good neighbor? A good neighbor is a neighbor who is ultimately a soul keeper. And I think it is a bit of a challenge, and I was trying to describe to you in my talk that after DOMA came out, you know, it was a beautiful summer night. We all took a walk together. We all bared our souls. We all talked across our differences. And part of why we were able to do that is because we are neighbors and we do love each other. But ultimately, it would not have been any benefit to me as a Christian if I had been allowed to marry my lesbian partner in 1997. That would have made my journey to Christ much, much harder. And so it's in that context that I would appeal to a good neighbor with an eternal perspective. And we need to find ways to say that, and we need to find ways also to respect where people are. I don't think that Christians are called to live in some kind of a delusional bubble. You know, if your gay and lesbian neighbors who are in committed, partnered, or even married relationships, and to some degree expect you to acknowledge them where they are at. And I think that that is an act of decency. But for me, supporting laws that would encourage any further separation from the God who made them and loves them better than I can would be of no real eternal benefit. Does that answer your question from my point of view, at least? Okay. I don't know if anybody else.
Well, I think I'll defend myself if I can, but it is a good question. And this is a trend I just noticed just recently. Over the last 12 years, I've had 5 gay or lesbian neighbors as I've lived in various states and cities. And our church is next door to a gay couple. We live next door to a lesbian couple. Our church are in very good terms with our neighborhood, which is a predominantly gay neighborhood. We are a very conservative church, maybe a super conservative church. But we have good relationships because we sought to have good relationships, and God blessed that. We were very intentional with at least one of our lesbian neighbors. I mean, we were buddies, she and I. You know, she drove me to Synod. You know, she makes ice cream for me on my birthday. I mean, we are close. And I've invited them many times to church, and one time they did. Both came to church. And just in God's providence, I was dealing with an imprecatory prayer that Wednesday night. They heard the gospel. We're still good friends. And so, and the Lord blesses that. She could be angry. She could hate me. That does happen, but we shouldn't fear that. And I think we just have an atmosphere of fear. If I live out my faith, people hate me, or I'll get fired. And we cannot, God has not told us to live in fear. We are to fear God, not man. Because the fear of God casts out the fear of man. So we are to be the church militant, but our warfare is not with arms. It's a spiritual warfare with prayer, the gospel, the truth, faith. We return good for the evil that we receive. We bless those who curse us. And it's a mighty way to fight the forces of evil. So yes, we are at war. We always are at war throughout the history of the church. But it's not the war of the world or the ways of the world, but it's the ways of Christ. And so I want to qualify, you know, Jesus sends a sword, and that's the word. And we got to use it wisely, and not as a club, but as God's truth with grace. And yet we pray for conviction. So we're here by God's grace because he convicted us of our sin. And we thank the Lord for that.
Yes, next question.
Sir, good evening. Rosario, you made a statement that you believe that the church is going to be facing persecution in the days to come. I believe you're right. Notwithstanding all that you said about being a good neighbor, which I endorse, I think there is indeed a clash in worldviews, and there will come a time when we will have to choose ultimately where our allegiance lies. I think the early church faced this problem. Peter had to decide whether or not, you know, he would speak out in the name of Christ. Daniel had to make a decision. Notwithstanding all that we talk about in terms of the laws in our country, will there not come a time when we as Christians will have to stand and at some point make a decision and be willing to stand and be persecuted, not necessarily to whine and complain about it, but will there not be a cost necessary for us who bear the name of Christ if we are going to be faithful? Will we not be asked at some point to lay something on the altar for our faith in the days to come? And how should the church respond, and what do you anticipate that that response should be? And what do you think about that, what that would look like in the days to come?
I think that's more of a comment than a question. Was there a question in that?
Yes, the question.
You're welcome to make a comment.
No, I'm not making a comment. I'm asking the question, is there ultimately a time when we will have to stand and make a decision to stand for our faith when the laws in the country are diametrically opposed to a biblical worldview? And we are coming to that stage. I believe we have already reached it. What are we supposed to do? That's the question.
That's
right. In your view.
Well, I think I'd like to defer to the pastors on the panel, but I will tell you that for my, in my heart, I have really been pondering this reality that Christians have been ashamed of the gospel. We have failed to bring the word in season or out of season, and I think that we are just simply bearing the fruit of our own man pleasing. I think that we have made people pleasing a sort of idol, and it was just something. I think it was just easier to make moral pot shots than really break our hearts for our neighbors, and I think we are paying for it. But ultimately, Christians are also called to die well. And I imagine that if we are in a state of persecution, that our churches will become places of vibrant and vital and real Christian hospitality. I believe that. I believe that we will band together in love. And I can imagine that in that persecution, there will truly be a beautiful aroma, and that it will be a winsome message, and that to some degree, we will have nothing more to lose. And so I will pray, and I do pray, that we will have boldness and that we will have courage not to stand against a perceived transgression of morality, because we are, after all, bearers of Christ. We are not a group of social prigs who simply happen to share a particular checklist of do's and don'ts. And God forbid, if we think that Jesus Christ came to die for something like that. But as Christ bearers, I believe that persecution, if it comes, will purify our love for God and our high value of good neighboring. And it will clarify any number of other things. But yes, Christians are called to die well, and we need to be praying to that end as well.
Just to add to that, I thought of Philippians 1:29, for it has been granted to you for the sake of Christ that not only that you should believe in him, but that you would also suffer for his sake. And I do think that in our world, our context as American Christians, we just know very little of the cost of discipleship, the cost of the life of the resurrection being manifest in our willingness to suffer. But I do think, and I don't think any of us are sort of alarmists in any kind of way, but I do think you can see what's happening as even now Christians are having to make decisions based upon their conviction, their conscience, that is actually beginning to be very costly, sometimes emotionally, relationally, but now financially. And I think you hit an American in their pocketbook, and that is the cost of discipleship for many of us. And I think for all of us, we're gonna have to get ready to make some very hard decisions in our businesses, in our personal lives, about a willingness to take a stand graciously, but then to suffer the consequences and be okay with that.
His wife is short too. So. I have a question as a parent of a teenager. Can you provide guidance in how Christian families should welcome teenagers who may or may not be entertaining same-sex attraction? We have teenagers in our home a lot, and on the surface, it seems as though some are perhaps considering that direction. And I don't want to be a moral prig. I do want to be welcoming and hospitable, but I also don't want to encourage overt behavior that actually is very funny. So there's a line there, and I was wondering if you have considered what does Christian hospitality look like when you have teenagers, because we do have a little bit of a responsibility as the adult, and yet we don't want to overstep because we don't have any facts. So could you help with that?
I think that people, teenagers or older folks like us, who are struggling with same-sex attraction and struggling in God's way are potentially heroes of our faith, because they are taking big risks and they are setting an example of a sacrificial love. And I know that Christ always holds up the heavier part of whatever cross we have to bear. But I would say that instead of viewing, you know, it's all in how you struggle. Because we all have sin that grabs us by the throat, right? And the definition of sin that we use comes from the book of Genesis, 4th chapter, when God says to Cain, "Sin is lurking at your door. Its desire is for you, but you will overcome it." That's a big enemy. And it makes it even harder if you have a church culture where it's not safe to say, "This is where I struggle." And you know, sometimes when it's not safe, we resort to anger or joke as a way to manage things. But I would say that people who are struggling with a sexual sin, but struggling with God's help, are heroes of our faith, not people to be feared or held at arm's length, but rather people to be drawn in close and valued for their commitment to purity. That's what I think. Anybody?
There's a wonderful statement in the Reformed tradition that grace restores nature. It doesn't abolish nature. And I think when you think in terms of the three primary institutions that God created, the church, the family, the state, it's so easy, even in these discussions, for the family to be lost sight of. And I think, to Rosaria's point earlier, I think if the church is willing to come under the microscope of God's word, there's a lot of logs in our eyes in this area in particular where we could stand to do some serious soul searching and repenting. We've been content with an externalistic definition of the family rather than the fruit of the gospel preaching of the church and then lived out in the family and serving as salt and light in the state and in the community. So I would think the fruit of the gospel within the church then lived out in the family. And keeping in mind that we're image bearers, that the family's a creation mandate so that every image bearer understands I was meant to have relationship with my family, and the mar of sin upon that relationship is unnatural, just as all sin. So a hospitable family where the joy of the gospel, not just, you know, Christian morals, but the gospel really as a centerpiece of that. And I think we could all like, testify when we've been in that environment, it smells good. It feels right. There's a disarming quality. So now the other danger is to isolate the family and to take that, you know, to make that the end all. That's certainly not the answer. But in right proportion, it seems like there's a lot of repenting that we could do. And even as parents, where we've been content, we've watched children externalistically jump through hoops, but we've not asked them about their souls. We've not asked them about the loves of their hearts and their friends as well. So I'd say, I mean, as a parent, look your children's friends in the eyes and say, how are you? What are you interested in? What do you want to be? Why do you want to do that with your life? Let me explain to you the hope of the gospel. And I think children are perceptive. They know when they're taken seriously that way, and that may melt false loves.
Thank you.
Your turn. Thanks. I can stay seated. First of all, I'd like to say thanks for your return and thanks for bringing Ken. We really appreciate that. So two things that I would say my family and I are really grateful for after reading your book and hearing your testimony is we were a very social family before, and I think we're scratching hospitality now, and so that's sort of a new excitement for us. The second thing really that we kind of wrestled with was pride being a root sin, and that's been not a fun thing, so we're not really happy of that chapter. But one of the things that we're starting to notice now creeping into our lives is the fear of man, and how I would have said at one time that I didn't do that, but today I realize, wow, in Christ, I'm still cowering at man. And so, you know, can you kind of address, as you are able to go into controversial areas where you obviously have a deep love for a community, but also there's a fear of man there, especially with children, and for reputation, and for embarrassment, and for all the fears of man that I really didn't understand. I thought it was just all physical. But can you kind of address that and say, okay, here are the prayers that we have, and here are the scriptures that we read? And
yeah, thank you. You know, it's funny, because that is something I really have been struggling with lately as the Lord has called me to return to the very community that I helped make, right? And that's a very, you know, that's humbling, it's humiliating, and, you know, and I too struggle with the fear of man. The best way, though, for me to deal with the fear of man is to be intentionally close to the holy God that made me and takes care of me and providentially has put me back into these ministries. And so, you know, I sort of joke about it, but it's not really a joke. I had to marry a pastor because I need daily biblical counseling, right? People don't realize that. Daily, sometimes hourly. And so Kent and I have always been committed prayer partners and committed to having lives that are not so busy that we don't have deep time in the Word and in, the, you know, some of the many, many things that really encourage us. But, you know, one of the things that really encourages me to not fear man is to boldly share the gospel with everybody. Because one of the things that happens when you boldly share the gospel is Jesus shows up when you get there. So, you know, if you want a renewed Christian joy, then you have to be bold. And so I don't think we've had really anything really bad happen, other than the fact that there are many people in, you know, especially my past, who think that I have three heads and I'm crazy, right? But, you know, in some ways we're all in the same boat. If you are a Bible-believing Christian and you believe in the inerrancy of Scripture, you know, for the most part, the world thinks you are a bigot or a moron or both. So the news is already out there, right? You know, you can't save yourself from that reputation. So you might as well go and take the conversation and turn those questions around and answer them. And we have experienced that, especially if you if you're willing to take risks and tell the truth and not hide behind, I don't know, sort of moral attacks. If you're willing to especially share your repentance. You know, we call it repentance unto life for a reason. And yet we have often been quite deceptive, I think, with one another about that. So I would, you know, what we have done certainly is spend great time in prayer with the ministry that the Lord has given me. I really don't go anywhere without spending, my hour in the morning in my devotions. If I decided to do any ministry on our own strength, I don't think we realize that is really robbing Christ. You know, that's actually an act of theft. You know, God gives us gifts, but, you know, really, who cares? God doesn't need those gifts. I'll tell you that whatever gifts God gave me, I've caused more harm with than good. I'm not impressed with them, and you shouldn't be either. It has been a joy to me. I mean, nothing short of a joy, and I think we were all talking about this over dinner. It has been a joy to be on the front line of Christian ministry. It has been both exhilarating and terrifying to be used of God. And, you know, this isn't something that you do because you write a book. You know, this is something that happens better behind the scenes. You know, I think some of the best Christian ministry is the behind-the-scenes ministry that happens in your houses with the doors closed, at your dinner table, in your classrooms, in your prayer closet. And I think that if we as a Christian community really committed ourselves to loving those means of grace that God has given us and to spending more time within them, I believe God would bless us so richly that we would be so exhilarated by the joy of the gospel that the fear would dissipate. So we have been blessed. We have been blessed to have experienced the Lord meeting us right there in the most terrifying places. And I would just encourage that to you, encourage that as a suggestion to you. Maybe my husband, though, who is more concerned with our well-being, might have something to say to this.
I'll share my bad experience, my sin, in order to motivate you to obedience and greater faith. Just a little snippet of my testimony. I was converted when I was 17. In a family that was not Christian. And in fact, I had several family members that were very hostile towards Christians. And through my conversion, I had a burden for my family and I prayed for my family every day, but I kept my faith secret for 2 years out of fear that they would reject me. And I realized every day as I prayed for them, who would witness to, I pray for their salvation, but who would witness to them? I'm the only Christian they know or they have access to in God's providence. So I saw there's a contradiction even in my prayers for their salvation. I was denying them the truth. I was praying for their souls, but denying them the truth at the same time. And, you know, the scripture passage where Jesus says, he who denies me before the Father, he who denies me before men, I will deny before the Father. And it just convicted me every day. Now, I wasn't brave enough to make my faith known. How it happened is, as we moved to North Carolina, I was transferring to University of North Carolina. My family was moving to Chapel Hill. And as we moved in, I found a Bible given by a Mormon missionary to my mother 13 years earlier. It was a King James Bible. It wasn't the Book of Mormon. And it was the only Bible in the house. So I took it. I went to my room, closed the door, and I started reading the Bible for the first time. I was converted through radio ministry, so this time, 2 years, I didn't go to church. I didn't read the Bible. I didn't interact with any Christians. I didn't know any. And my mother discovered me reading the Bible. And she opened the door, told me dinner was ready, and she said, what are you reading? I said, the Bible. And she asked, well, how long have you been reading that? I said, well, I just started it. Actually, I did, just that day. And so we kind of joke around that as Rosaria in her former lifestyle was very open, I was not as a Christian. So I'm the one that came out of the closet. Literally, you know, I came out of the closet. I mean, I was exposed. And, but, you know, so I know I'm probably more bold and blunt today because I've lost time. I've had family members die, and I've never shared the faith with them. I can't make it up. So I don't want to live under that fear anymore.
Thank you both for coming. I read your book this summer, and it really helped me articulate why I go to a Reformed Orthodox church, why I worship at a church like Holy Trinity, and also the Orthodox Presbyterian Church, that I worship here because the gospel is the main event. It's not, you know, we don't have slideshows, we don't have a rock band, so... And as a young person, it was really hard for me to tell people that, especially when I wanted to bring my my non-believing friends to worship with me. But my question is I have several friends that are Christians that struggle with same-sex attraction, and I was just wondering, how can I encourage them? How can I keep them accountable? And also, how can I just get in their head and show them the gospel when the church that they've been raised in tells them that their sin is graver than mine?
Oh, yeah. So those are great questions. You know, one of the things that I love about Reformed theology is that it simplifies some complex things. And, you know, ultimately, you know, the purpose of worship is worship. The purpose is to give God glory. It's not to be entertained or amused or to have your ears tickled, right? And so for me, it's just very helpful that we have these clarifying things. You know, I think that you encourage your friends with same-sex attraction by being clear on a couple of things. You know, the one is, although people make choices along the way of their lives. Most people who struggle with same-sex attraction do not consider it a choice. You know, I don't really think anybody just gets up one day and says, you know, I'm just going to choose this. This looks kind of interesting. You know, let's choose that. I think that the power of original sin in our lives, sin is deceptive. And I think that we have often been very careless as Christians with two topics, original sin and election. I think, sadly, we've been ashamed of those. I think we've tried to share the gospel without those. You know, and I remember for years when I was an atheist, having people come up to me and say things like, you know, Jesus is the answer. And I'd say, oh, interesting, what's the question? You know, and like, oh, I don't know, you know, it's not on my script, you know. Oh, okay, well, I have some questions. No, don't do that, you know. So I don't know. I mean, I think that if we would just be honest with people and say, you know, we were born that way. We all were born that way, and we are no different. Nobody gets a free pass. We're all on the same boat. It's miserable. But here's the really good news. If God has set you apart from before the foundations of the world, then this struggle is not one you're going to have to ever go alone. Not in an eternal way or in a contextual way. You have God and you have me and you have this church. And you know, at least in my experience, probably the scariest thing about same-sex attraction, once you are convicted that it is a sin, one of the scariest things is the idea that you will grow old alone, that you will be lonely, and that you will be forgotten. And one of the things we can do is also be mindful as a church that we are not to despise singleness. And I think sometimes we do. You know, I think the world says, you know, you're a grown-up when you have sex. And the church says, you're a grown-up when you have sex. Just get married first. And so we look at our singles and we try to fix them or fix them up. You know, sometimes it's hard, I know, with hospitality. But, you know, sometimes it's really nice to not have sort of context-segregated groups. You know, sometimes it's nice just to, you know, hang out together. Open invitation, not, you know, the singles here and the, you know, young adults here. But just, you know, we're Christians, just hang together. So I think that, you know, one of the best ways as Christians that we can minister to anyone is to find out where it really hurts. You know, where does it really hurt? And you know, I'm always amazed as I reread the Bible. And you know, I this is sort of my soapbox these days. Christians are not readers; we're rereaders. You know, and we're rereaders because we know that this Bible is a supernatural text. And if we don't meet the Lord there every day, we're going to miss a blessing. We're going to miss something. And maybe that blessing wasn't intended for us, but maybe something that we were to bestow upon someone else. You know, there are so many friends that we have who could not find the throne of grace right now. And, you know, how important it is that we realize that our time of devotions in the morning is not a selfish time, but really a covenantal time. But you know, I think that finding out where it hurts sometimes means that you have to sit by the side of the pool with someone. You know, when Jesus saw the man at the side of the pool and he said, do you want to be made well? Well, you know, sometimes people have to really ponder that, right? Because the way Jesus heals it can be a very painful experience. Right. I mean, it can be a very, very, it is an overhauling. And so I think being a good friend means saying, well, I'm going to sit here by the side of the pool with you. You don't have to sit there alone. The other thing that I have found important is sometimes when you're struggling with a particular sin, there's a danger in maybe overplaying it, but almost praying to the very sin that's the problem. So at least for me, when I am trying to be a good friend to someone who is struggling with same-sex attraction, I think it's really helpful to look at something like, well, you know, Kent likes to go through the Ten Commandments. Or I like to go through the shorter catechism or the larger catechism. To go through something that gives you a sense of the bigness of God and the capaciousness of his grace and his power and his majesty and his authority. And that to me is very helpful because indeed, if we are to flee to the arms of the Almighty, part of why we're fleeing there is that we are very small and he is very great. And if we make ourselves great by spending maybe too much time focusing on our sin, it can almost spook us. But my general advice is to spend as much time listening as you are talking, to really listen to where people are, to praying together, and part of how you make yourself a trustworthy friend is to be as strong and shored up in the Lord as you can. Does that help?
One last question. This is actually, also I just want to thank you for just claiming Christ as an academic. I know that's a really brave thing to do, not to jump into argumentation and intellect, but just to claim him. So thank you for that. But this is more to the pastors. I know I have a lot of friends who have struggled with homosexuality but are afraid to approach a pastor or an organized church structure because they're afraid of church discipline, especially, say, in the Presbyterian tradition where very proud of, and rightly so, as an organized structure of church discipline. So I'm glad the young lady brought up some sins being emphasized as graver than others, so they feel that maybe there isn't going to be a patience with them that is allowed with an alcoholic or with somebody struggling with pornography or something else. So they feel that they're in a special case and that they may be thrown out too soon, and they're really struggling with giving up somebody very important in their life and giving up a very tender relationship or something like that. So as pastors, what is your plan to have patience that gives to perseverance, but still having the balance of disciplining when you need to discipline and there isn't true repentance after a period of time? It's a very hard balance, and I was just wondering your thoughts on that.
It's a very hard balance. You're absolutely right. I guess I would say two things. The first thing would be that as ministers, but as Christians, if we're not first taking the log out of our own eye in these kinds of areas, if we're not deeply aware of our own sin and the way in which we have broken God's law in these very kinds of ways, if we can't genuinely say to anyone in any sin, I could be where you are tomorrow and know that it's true, then we're not able to exercise proper patience with anyone who's struggling with any sin. So that's sort of the personal side. And then I would say too that I think we would all say that church discipline, which is very broad in its scope, it includes the regular preaching of the word, it includes the encouragement of fellow believers, but it really is a means of grace. It's one of the means that God has appointed for all of us to persevere through the wilderness of this world. So to believe God at his word, that this is one of the means of the very means of grace. And if it has to be exercised tenderly with great patience, as you said, with real sensitivity to the individual and their need, their situation. And that's as much an art as a science as you can imagine.
I guess several things I would say. You mentioned in your hypothetical question, you know, if somebody's struggling, I mean, that's a good sign. That's an encouraging sign to elders. If somebody is struggling in a sin, you know, hopefully the elders are practicing godliness in their Christ-given role. They'll be working with that individual. They'll be seeking a counsel or bringing other people along to help. I mean, biblical discipline does not happen immediately. And it depends on the circumstance. And if it's a private struggle, then it's going to be a private matter of the elders with that individual. So, you know, if you say someone's concerned about being disciplined, that's encouraging. The people when I've been involved with a session to discipline somebody, and there's been times dealing with, you know, sexual sin, even youth and sexual sin, usually when we have brought forth a formal discipline, is because they didn't care. They were defiant, not just to the session, but to the Word of God, obviously you only, you know, discipline members. They disregarded their vows of membership and their confession of faith that they've made. And usually, it might have been over a year-long process of trying to deal with somebody. I mean, usually churches, the criticism from those who look from afar, you take too long to discipline. And sometimes church is too hasty. You know, we're fallible men, we'll make terrible mistakes and seek God's forgiveness and try to do better. But if somebody's struggling, that's an encouraging sign, but that they need to be open, because even though, I mean, this is where Satan works his best, when he wants to put into your mind, I cannot confess the sin I've committed against somebody else, or that I'm doing, I cannot, you know, talk to somebody about it because of the shame. That is Satan speaking. That is not Christ speaking. Christ says, bring your burden, lay it at my feet, bring it to the cross, and he will forgive, and he'll take away the guilt. The shame is Satan working to manipulate us. And we have to be careful not to say to somebody, it'd be shameful if you commit this sin. You bring shame on our family, whatever it is. We will feed into the propaganda of Satan. So we have to be humble. We have to be broken. And we don't like that. We're prideful. We're prideful. And even as Christians, we're prideful. We have to work at humility. So, you know, I mean, obviously it's going to be a long conversation, you know, with somebody who's struggling. You know, what should I do if they're asking a friend, another Christian? But, you know, discipline is a positive, because the purpose of discipline, if it comes to that, even to the point of excommunication, and usually that would be because you're defying the rebuke, or the, you know, we'll start with the admonition, rebuke, or maybe suspension of the Lord's Supper. And when it's suspension, you know, it might be made public at that point. But they're being defiant, and just encourage them, you know, go to the cross. You know, don't heighten the issue for yourself. Don't make it harder for yourself. But, you know, if we're humble, then, you know, and then the fear of man comes into that too, that problem which we talked about.
All right, well, thank you all for coming tonight. You should have received one of these cards on your way in. If you would like to offer up any comments for the program tonight, and especially if you would like to receive emails about future conversations, you can just jot your email on that card and leave it at the end of the pew, and our ushers will pick it up.
Thank you all so much for being here tonight. And thanks again to Rosaria.